wake up with a shine, I struggle to memorize. Whiff up between the thighs, pleasure that made you cry. It feels so good to be bad, not worth the aftermath. After that, I try to get you back. I still don't have a reason. Forget about the truth. I still don't have a reason. You don't have the time. And it really makes me wonder if I ever gave up about you. Give me something to believe in. Cause I don't believe in you anymore, anymore. I wonder if it even makes a difference.
Influenced by soul and R&B, this L.A. rock band released their 2002 Grammy-winning debut, Songs About Jane, which turned into a worldwide blockbuster. It launched numerous chart-topping hits, many of which they're going to perform for us right here in our studio. An exclusive acoustic performance that you won't see anywhere else. This morning, we are pleased to be spending the next hour with Maroon 5, starting now on Private Sessions. My guests today are the rock and soul band Maroon 5, who have recently made the highest leap in Billboard history with their new single, Makes Me Wonder. It jumped from 64 to number one in just 1 week. Welcome to the show, Adam Levine, James Valentine. So good to have you guys here.
It's good to be here.
How does it feel to make Billboard history? That's quite an impressive thing. Billboard's been around almost 50 years now, and that's never happened.
I know. I think that it's timing, too, because the music world is kind of going through a little bit of a shift with the internet and all those things. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it is an amazing feat. But
I think what allowed us to do that is the fact that the digital downloads are counted now. So, again, like, people are buying singles because that sort of went away for a while.
It's the 50s again.
Yeah.
It is. It is kind of a cool renaissance. Mm-hmm. Now, this album has got accolades from everybody, from the media and the press, and it's really well-deserved. But what I want to know is, how do you guys feel about It Won't Be Soon Before Long? You know, you've got the finished product out there, and people are digging. Are you happy with it, or was it a struggle for you?
Yeah, I mean, you know, you'll always be second guessing yourself. You'll always be working on it until it's out there on the shelves, you know.
I think if you're 80% satisfied and 20% disappointed, it's a pretty good ratio so that you can push yourself to make something better next time, but also kind of be happy with where you are in the moment. And I think that's where we wound up.
Yeah. It's always nice to know that you guys like it. I mean,
I like it better than our first record. Our first record, we finished our first album, and I actually didn't really like it very much, and I was upset about that.
Was that because it happened so fast, or was...
No, I mean, it was much more... We had less time, less money, obviously, less experience because we were so young.
Right.
And kind of just trying this for the first time. So it was just difficult. But I think that once it became this monster, we embraced it, and we were like, okay, wow. Because we really thought it could be huge. We thought it was going to be huge, and then when we were done, we thought, oh, man. I remember talking to Jesse, our keyboard player, saying, man, we blew it. This record will never be big.
Serious? So you didn't even have any idea?
Not really. I always had confidence that we could make it as a band, but this, I just felt a little bit discouraged for about a year, 6 months to a year, because it was also a very slow build to success. So I kept thinking, oh, man, you know, is it going to happen? So, you know, it's a very different process. The second time around, it was like, you know, media blitz. Oh, my God, we're really big.
I know most of you have known each other since you were very young, but I hear you argue about everything, including this album, whether it should be more rock or more R&B, and that's kind of why you ended up with both.
That push and pull is kind of the way that our band works, you know. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I tend to want it to be very perfect and super basic and really simple and almost metronome perfect. And then there's the other half.
And James comes and in with James, all his ideas.
But, you know, James wants to be more of a rock record, and I don't. You know, I know at this point what I'm going to hear from everybody else, so I can kind of factor that in. I think that we know each other's tastes and tendencies, so that just keeps getting better, and our bond keeps getting stronger because we start to really appreciate what each other has to offer to the band. But no, that's going to be a fight always. You know, we definitely haggle over those little minor details.
We spend so much time together that we'll just argue.
Just to pass the time. Yeah. Well, hopefully you won't argue on the show. We're going to talk more about them arguing and making more great music. When we come back, we find out how the band morphed into Maroon 5. And later, they'll perform their global hits, This Love and She Will Be Loved. Plus, material from their new release, It Won't Be Soon Before Long. Stay with us. He really needs no introduction, other than to say that he's still rocking and rolling with a little help from his friends. Next week, we'll be spending the hour with the one and only Ringo Starr. Bye. Welcome back to the show. We're spending this hour with Maroon 5. Now, before they became Maroon 5, Adam, Jesse, Mickey, and Ryan formed a band called Kara's Flowers when they were back in junior high school. And they actually had success selling out shows on the Sunset Strip, getting a record deal at 17 while still in high school, only to be dropped at 18, and then they disbanded to college. All right, guys, now before we continue, there was someone who knew you back in the day that knew you were going to be on the show today, and they really wanted to ask you a question. So, if you don't mind, take a look.
Hey, you guys. Michelle Branch here. A lot of people don't realize, but I know Maroon 5. I've known them for quite a while. We were both opening up for Evan and Jaren before my album was even released, and you guys were touring as Kara's Flowers, and I have a lot of memories of you guys, and I have one question. If you guys had been successful initially as Kara's Flowers early on, how do you think that would have changed the band and all your success now? Do you think we would all be sitting here?
Interesting question. Whoa. Michelle Branch.
Hey, I love Michelle Branch.
Wow. She's such a sweetheart.
That is a good question. What do you think?
I think that, you know, I wasn't a part of Kara's Flowers, so I can't really speak for them, but I think, like, but I will.
But are you going?
But I'm going to go ahead and do that. But, you know, they were like 17, 18 when that record came out. And, you know, if you see people who, you know, get success that early and it can really screw up their lives, I think, like, the fact that...
He's holding it together well, isn't he?
Yeah, he's doing well now, but that's because he had a few years of failure. And it wasn't until, you know, we were well into our 20s that we sort of started to do well. And, you know, somebody, I don't remember who said it, but somebody said that you sort of stop developing as a person, like, the moment you achieve fame, you know. So I'm glad that we got to sort of get into our adulthood.
For the rest of our lives.
Well, I hope that's
kind of where I feel like I'm stuck.
Lucky you.
I feel 23 right now.
Perpetually?
Yeah, I think that if Cars Flowers had happened, I'd be kind of miserable because we were so young when we started that band that I didn't love the music we were making and kind of just only liked it so-so.
It was totally different than Maroon 5.
It was very different, and we were still exploring who we were. So I wouldn't have wanted that to become who I was as a musician or as a songwriter. It was kind of like workshop, very public workshop, because we had a little bit of success. But that, and also, yes, you absolutely can get stunted by early success. And I mean, if I was 18, we were so, I mean, cockier than we even are now, believe it or not. And I was so, when I think about how cocky I was, maybe I was overcompensating a bit, you know, but man, if we had been successful, I would have felt, because I didn't go to college, so if that had happened.
Didn't you guys kind of take off?
For a minute. We went to school for a little short while, but I definitely wouldn't call it a college experience.
Okay.
I don't know if I would have been able to handle it.
So you believe that really things do happen for a reason, and obviously.
I think we were actually ready. We had paid our dues. Yeah. We had worked. We had toured for 2 years.
You haven't met me yet.
In a van down by the river.
Down by the river with Chris Farley. No, but he, yeah, and then he joined. And when James joined, that's when we really became, I have to give credit where credit is due. He joined. And
Nebraska's in the house.
Exactly. The rest is history, yeah.
I just learned that before, actually, during the break, that James is from Nebraska. That's and true. I was going to ask you, did that little bit of experience before you hooked up with James in 2001 and created Maroon 5, do you think any part of that experience happened to be the reason why you regrouped the band again after being dropped from your first record label?
Yeah, well, we really had thought that our first album was going to be, or our first band was going to be huge. Mm. And to our surprise, it was a very humbling surprise, is that we graduated high school, then they put us on the road for 6 months. And at the end of that 6 months, I think we had sold like 800 records or something like that, and they dropped us from Warner Brothers. And we were just so deflated. And we thought, oh,
I can imagine.
Fortunately, we kind of had our mid-career crisis when we were 18.
Yeah, it sounds like it.
Because no, honestly, because there was so much hype. We got a pretty decent record deal. We had some money in our pocket, you know. All very rare things for a young band just out of high school. So we took that time and thought, we really are worth it, and we got to stick it out. We said to ourselves, we're going to give it one more try before we found James. One more try, and then if this doesn't work, we'll probably separate and pursue other things.
You guys really got a second chance when you morphed into Maroon 5, and that doesn't happen. It's so rare in the music industry. A first chance is rare in the music industry. So was it a hard sell for you, especially with you really introduced a new musical genre to the, you know, to the music world?
We were so blessed to have another opportunity because, yeah, once you're tainted goods in the record industry, it's really hard to get people's belief back, you know, because, you know, the record business is so corrupt and weird anyway that once they spent a lot of money on that first band. Yeah. And you just get that reputation, oh, they're from that band that failed and all of those things. Mm-hmm. And it sucks because you have to really overcome it. So fortunately, we got a record deal again, which is strangely rare. And some guys that really believed in us, the Octone guys.
Yeah.
And it was amazing. It was an amazing
twist
of fate.
You guys toured your butts off, too. Like, what, 3 years you were out on the road behind Songs About Jane, which was released in 2002, but it wasn't an instant hit. No, and that was because you came up the old-fashioned way, right?
We literally started playing in clubs when there was no one watching us. Yeah. And by the end of that tour, when we stopped touring on Songs About Jane, we had gone from empty bars to arenas. And it's just a dream come true. And it doesn't even seem real.
Yeah.
You know, the fact, and we don't take it for granted. We really appreciate everything. Every day. We always talk about how bizarre and crazy it is that this all happened, you know?
Well, something struck me that you guys weren't the type of people that would want to just have that instant fame. You wanted to touch all of your fans, and let's face it, you built fans all over the world by getting out there and really pushing it, and it worked out really well for you.
It was our only choice. I mean, we were on an independent label, and it was sort of a new model for the music industry. Mm-hmm. It actually resembles the way that bands used to
developing
them and touring them.
Novel idea.
Yeah, it's a novel idea, but you
go
know,
on tour. You know, we weren't exactly darlings of the media either. You know, we didn't have any of those things that you really need to kind of become a big band. So we're like, you know what, we're gonna put that aside and we're gonna just become a legitimate touring band. And then whatever happens will happen. And fortunately, all the stars were aligned, you know.
Well, coming up, how Maroon 5 stays connected with their fans by keeping it real themselves. Plus, their global hit, This Love, live in our studio when Private Sessions returns right after this. Stay with us.
My whole life, Lazy Boy Furniture Galleries.
Once again, here is Maroon 5 with This Love.
So high, I did not recognize the fire burning in her eyes, the chaos that controlled my mind. Whispered goodbye, she got on a plane, never to return again, but always in my heart. Tried my best to feed her appetite and keep her coming every night. So hard to keep her satisfied. Keep playing love like it was just a game. Pretend it don't feel the same. Turn around and leave again. But oh, this love has taken its toll on me. She said goodbye too many times before. Everything's alright. My pressure on your head, sticking my fingertips to every inch of you, 'cause I know it's what you want me to do. This love has taken its toll on me. She said goodbye too many times before.
We just heard This Love, one of Maroon 5's international hits, which also earned them a Grammy Award. And this tune helped transform that band from struggling rockers to one of the biggest blue-eyed soul acts ever. How important is it to you guys to be honest in your lyrics? Because I know, you know, like you said, this time around, this album isn't necessarily all about things that happened specifically to you and one other person. It's what you observed with other people as well.
Yeah.
But is it important to be honest, though, in all of the lyrics?
To me, if it's not honest, it doesn't work. No one believes you. Mm. You know, I've tried to write songs before. I want to write a song about how the world should be a better place. The world should be a better place. It's like, oh, blech, garbage. You know?
You don't or think like, the world should be a better place?
It should be, but it's not going
to be. It should be a horrible place.
Let me tell you something. The world should be, I wish it could be, but it's not going to become a better place by me writing songs like that. So, you know, I kind of started to realize that I had to play to my strengths. But, yeah, I learned over the years that you can't try and write a song. You just have to kind of write about how you're feeling, and then it has to be a really natural thing. Mm. If you fake it, it's people pick up on it. It's really weird. If you're feeling genuinely happy about life, mm-hmm. you could probably write a happy song, which is a tough thing. But if you're feeling conflicted and miserable, you tend to write those are when you write. That's when you write the best songs. And then you just throw a catchy melody on it, and
there you got it.
Yeah,
so easy, so easy.
Simple.
All right. Speaking of putting together a song, whose idea was it to put together this album in the haunted Houdini mansion? And did you all sleep there?
I wouldn't stay there.
No, I was.
You wouldn't stay.
I was the only one who stayed there the entire time.
Is it truly haunted?
Well, I mean,
are there any creepy stories?
I don't really know how to explain it, but like one night, I was there with my girlfriend at the time, and we were about to go to bed, and she went upstairs, and I walked out, and there was a hallway that went up. There was a second and third floor, and I saw somebody walking up to the third floor, and I was so certain that I called out. I thought it was my girlfriend, so I called out to her, but she was on the second floor.
Ooh.
When I got up there, I saw that she was not there, and then I went up to the third floor and didn't see anyone. So I don't know what I saw. I can't really explain it, but
it was
a little bit creepy, but yeah. I wasn't scared.
And so you wouldn't even stay there.
I walked in and said the first I just thought, wow, no way. I have creepy feelings about some houses like that, especially in LA, creepy Spanish awesome houses that I would love to hang out in but not ever sleep in. And I just was creeped out immediately, but it was cool.
What's the worst that's gonna happen? Houdini's gonna start raggling some chains at night, and I'm gonna get out of the box.
There was just no way. I went up to the bedrooms. It was a creepy place. It wasn't fancy. It was just kind of decrepit.
Did it help though to inspire you guys though?
Definitely.
Yeah, it was just great to have all the instruments set up all the time, 24/7. We were ready to record.
Also, we had watched this documentary of the making of Blood Sugar Sex Magik, the Chili Peppers.
Chili Peppers, yeah.
They recorded that album there, and I remember always, it's such a historical LA spot, you know, it's such a rock and roll place, and it's this haunted mansion in Laurel Canyon, and it's literally the coolest place, vibe-wise, you could ever be in. So we were so jazzed to be there that we had fun, you know. We wrote some good songs.
Hopefully no spirits followed you home.
No, I got scared walking from the tracking room to my car.
Wow.
I kind of jogged a little. You know, you do that I'm scared jog.
Yeah, you get that feeling that someone's behind you. All right, when we come back, Maroon 5 performs another top hit, She Will Be Loved. A&E's Private Sessions continues in just a moment.
She will be loved. She will.
From Maroon 5's Grammy-winning debut album, Songs About Jane, here's She Will Be Loved.
Beauty queen of only 18, she had some trouble with herself. He was always there to help her. She always belonged to someone else. Drove for miles and miles and wound up at your door. Had you so many times, but somehow I want more. I don't mind spending every day out on your corner in the pouring rain. Look for the girl with a broken smile. Ask her if she wants to stay a while. She will be loved. She will be loved. Yeah. Tap on my window, knock on my door. To get so insecure, doesn't matter anymore. It's not always rainbows and butterflies, it's compromise moves us along. My heart is full, my door is always open. Come anytime you want, and I don't mind spending every day out on your corner in the pouring rain. Look for the girl with a broken smile and ask her if she wants to stay a while. She will be loved. She will be loved. Oh, she will be loved. She will. I know goodbye means nothing at all. Comes back and bites me. Catch her every time she falls. Tap on my window, knock on my door. I wanna make you feel beautiful. I don't mind spending every day out on your corner in the pouring rain. Oh, look for the girl with a broken smile. Ask her if she wants to stay a while. She will be loved. She will be loved. She will. She will be loved. Please don't try so hard to say goodbye. Yeah, 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 yeah.
That was She Will Be Loved, another one of Maroon 5's chart-topping hit singles. All right, you guys, we last left, and I didn't get a chance to ask you this. You've toured with some amazing bands during your very short career, incredible career, one of which were The Police not too long ago. What was that like for the experience?
That was incredible. I don't think we ever really expected them to get back together.
It was shocking.
Yeah, it really was. And so it was a great opportunity. You know, when you're playing in front of a legendary band like that, and we had done that with the Rolling Stones, you know, you kind of just get through your set because, you know, people have, you know, paid hundreds of dollars and they're waiting for these legends, you know. But the set actually went pretty well, and I think we got the crowd engaged by it. And Sting came by our dressing room and said hello, which was very gracious of him.
I was going to ask you if you got a chance to meet him. He's a wonderful guy.
He's a great guy.
Very, very sweet.
Incredible.
If I can remember the name of it, it's so new. Cut number 7. Is
I don't know.
Oh, come on, you know.
Nothing Lasts Forever?
It's got this great homage to The Police in it. It's got that little
Won't Go Home Without You.
Won't Go Home Without
yeah.
You.
Yeah, yeah.
My favorite song of the album.
Yeah, we
We decided to go for it. It was funny because the songwriting isn't too policey, everybody's take-ish, but we thought, hey, we're making the record, we're like, they're not getting back together. You know, what are we going to get persecuted?
Oh, get out of here.
This record came out 20 years, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
And then literally, when we released our record, they were like, Police reunion tour. And
it was
like,
come on.
Cool. Sweet, guys. Thank you. I feel like somebody called our bluff, you know?
It sounds like it.
But, in retrospect, it was kind of a funny. We kind of really went for it. But to me, I always wanted to write that song. I was just jealous that I didn't get to write it, so.
Now, do you know when you guys have either put this, like, the perfect melody together, do you know instantly? Or when you write the perfect lyrics, do you know it instantly that this is going to be?
Sometimes I don't even like it.
Really?
And I have to be convinced by either band members
or the
public at large that this is a good song. And I kind of think,
well, they're like your children.
I'm terribly insecure about almost everything I write. It's even hard for me to write music in front of my band in a strange way. It's weird. I have to be kind of alone for a short period of time before I can present it to you guys.
Well, and that's kind of the cool thing about being in a band is, you know, a lot of times, you know, a lot of the parts on the record that anybody came up with was, you know, just maybe something that somebody was jamming on, and then everybody's like, oh, wait, that's cool, you know, like, do that again. And so there's sort of a committee. So, you know, like when Adam brings a song in, you know, it's usually pretty unanimous, you know, we all agree if it's going to be something that we're going to.
Is it like just all unanimous thumbs up, or are you all like, get out of here?
Generally, if there's not like an enthusiasm behind an idea, then it's just going to die.
And sometimes I'll be the lone man out. I'll say, I don't like this, and everyone will be like, you're crazy, man. And then I kind of start to love it.
That was kind of like on Makes Me Wonder, you know? Like,
Makes Me Wonder, I couldn't stand that song. I didn't want to finish it. I was very reluctant to finish it because I wasn't really particularly inspired by it, especially because it was such an older song.
Yeah, it's what you had it for, 4 years, just kind of shelved.
Yeah, so I was like, really, this one? Mm. And then I couldn't have predicted in a million years it would have been a hit as big as it was. So, I don't claim to know anything about whether a song is going to be a hit or not. I just kind of work here.
Well, the song that you're about to play for us before we take a break, I'm so excited, is another one off your new album. It's called Won't Go Home Without You. And I understood that you kind of had an inkling about something. You were in the car and you thought of the song, or
I was pulling into my driveway. This is probably 5 years ago, a long time ago. I think it was right when our first album was coming out, or right around that time when it had just come out. And I wrote that refrain in the chorus, "I won't go home without you," that whole chorus, and it happened in 30 seconds. I wrote this hook, and I had that hook, and I thought, okay, cool. We will have a career beyond songs about Jane, because as long as I keep this song in my back pocket, we'll be all right. And I rarely know, you know, that those types of things, or have any kind of intuition involving those types of things, but it felt like that. I was like, okay, great, this is such a powerful hook. I just need to write a song around it, and I'm good, because I'm a chorus person. I like to write choruses. And then once you get the chorus out of the way, everything else is effortless because you're servicing this great thing that you've come up with. So I thought, hey, we're going to be all right. Not a one-hit wonder.
No, they're not. Definitely, three. You beat the sophomore slump, as they call it.
I think we did, yeah. It took some fighting, but we did it.
All right. Well, we will be back in a moment. But first, from Maroon 5's new release, It Won't Be Soon Before Long, here's Won't Go Home Without You.
I asked her to stay, she wouldn't listen. She left before I had the chance to say, oh, where did we met? Things that were broken. Now it's far too late, she's gone.
Maroon 5 performs another hit song Sunday morning when A&E's Private Sessions returns, so stay with us.
Driving slow on
Sunday morning, I never want to leave.
Thursday at 10 on A&E.
Welcome back to Private Sessions. My guests are Maroon 5, and I've been having such a fun time with you guys. I hope you have been, too. It's been
absolutely
wonderful.
Good.
We have to have a little fun with you, though. Actually, some other people wanted to have some fun with you, and they couldn't actually be here to do it.
All these special guests.
Yes.
This is awesome.
First off, we have a friend from your hometown. This is Your Life. Check it out.
Whoa. Hey, remember when you were Cara's Flowers, and you opened up for Crosby, Stills, and Nash? You had a couple of Brentwood School benefits? Well, Crosby, Stills, and Nash are going on the road this summer, and you want to come open for us? You sure could use the exposure, right?
Isn't that great? Graham Nash.
You
guys,
did you guys like hold the gun to Graham's hand and make him do this?
No, they were excited. Listen, you guys, people really dig your music, and people really want to be a part of it. It
That'll
must be strange for you.
Awesome tour.
Yeah.
Crosby, Stills, and Nash.
That would
like,
be incredible.
Nobody would, the world would not be expecting that.
Would you guys do it? Not that I'm putting you under the pressure to
The answer is yes, Graham. We would love to come on tour with you. He was such a huge part of our lives.
In what way?
Because Graham's, the family, I've always been, I've been friends with his kids for years. And when we were 19, 20 and kind of down and out and in need of some help, not just, spiritually and financially, I guess, he was there. I mean, we came into, I was with his son, Will, who's one of my best friends in the world, and we were sitting in the living room, and he took me aside and said, "Hey, Adam, how's it going?" And, because he was always wanted to give back and help out where he could, because he's a wonderful human being. And he said, and I told him, I said, "We're a little frustrated right now. We're making demos, and we don't know where we're going, and our direction is unknown." And he said, "What's your favorite studio? And, when can I put you in there to do this?" And he ended up really paying for this batch of demos that would eventually get us signed. So he played a huge role in our development as a band, and he also played at our graduation. He was our speaker. He was our keynote speaker at our graduation, or
that's
whatever you
great.
Call it.
Yeah, we all had it in high school, right?
Yeah, yeah. And he played Teach, and I went to this very preppy, kind of uncool rah-rah football school, and felt a little bit like I stuck out. I didn't have much in common with a lot of the kids that went there, except for the rest of my band. And then I saw him doing this, and I was so inspired. And oddly enough, I wasn't inspired a day of my life in high school until I was a senior, and I saw that happen. So
he
was really amazing. God bless him. I love him so much.
Well, it looks like we might just see you guys out on tour together.
That'd be
sometime soon. That would be really cool.
I would love to do that.
All right, before we run out of time, we have another colleague of yours who just had to ask a question over you. So take a look.
I'm enjoying this.
Hey, what's up, dudes? And what's up, everybody? I'm Mark McGrath from Sugar Ray and the current co-host of your favorite entertainment news program, Extra. And I've got some very fond memories of Maroon 5, in particular a tour we did in 2003 with Matchbox 20. It was Matchbox 20, Sugar Ray, and then get this, Maroon 5 opening for us. And I guess my question now, after seeing Maroon 5 rip it up at the Staples Center last year with Adam's Lakers guitar, which is the coolest thing I've ever seen, is there any chance we can make that prophecy come true I had on stage and have Sugar Ray open for you guys at the Staples Center? One show, we'll take that 7-15 spot, we'll play sound check, we'll bring the treadmill, for Christ's sake. What do you say, guys? I mean, I'm serious. We'd love to do that. I'm serious. Anyways, you guys, congratulations. Good luck. I mean, you deserve everything you had coming to you and everything that's going to be coming to you. And keep making records, man. We love you guys. Couldn't happen to a nicer, more talented group of guys. Take care, man.
I love Mark McGrath.
Sweetest dude. Such a nice guy. He's funny. We opened up for them when they were opening up for Matchbox, and he let me use his treadmill, which is pretty sweet.
I was going to ask what the treadmill meant, but I thought maybe that was like musician talk.
That's where that comes from. No, it's literally, he actually brought the treadmill on that tour. I thought it was so cool that a band could have a treadmill out on the road. I thought that was like,
that was
the height of
luxury. Now you guys probably have a truck with a gym in it.
Now we have a full track.
Yeah, right. No. A whole track
we put it around the arena.
Yeah, and they go around with the little white lines and make it all free before you show up. That's great.
Yeah.
Well, listen, before we say goodbye, I'm really thrilled that you guys are going to do one more song for us this morning. And I can't even imagine ending the show in a better way Sunday morning than with your song Sunday morning. So thank you for that. And thank you for spending your time with us. Oh, quick question. Will there be a third album?
Yeah.
All right.
Absolutely.
Just want to make sure you're coming back.
I'm pretty sure. Now that Mark has put the pressure on.
Yes. That's right. Well, best of luck to you all, and thank you very much for being here. We hope to see you again for the next album.
Yes.
If not sooner.
Absolutely.
Excellent.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you. Thanks for being here. Once again, here is another Maroon 5 hit, Sunday Morning. For more on Maroon 5, go to the Private Sessions page on our website, aetv.com. Now, we're also very eager to hear what you have to say about our show. Now, you can join our discussion board or email us directly at privatesessions@aetn.com. Now, next week on Private Sessions, we'll be spending an exclusive hour with the one and only Ringo Starr. Join us only on A&E. I'm Lynn Hoffman, and I will see you right here next Sunday on Private Sessions. Ooh.
I'm gonna try this.